So, hello everybody. My name is Jan, and it's a pity that I couldn't
Oh,
make
I
it
see. You are from Italy.
to Pécs. And yeah, so we own Apot Kívánok, as we say in Hungarian, we Hungarians. And my paper, I hope you can see it, is basically focused on the rise and fall of Pan-Ethiopianism and Pan-Somalism. And it's meant to be it's kind of an opening floor for further debate, because I'm pretty sure that the speakers that go after me, like Balázs and Alemayo, will somehow get back to it as well. I'll try to make it very brief because we have only 15 minutes, so I hope I'll make it like a high-speed train. So what I'm going to do in this presentation is basically to touch a bit, the Horn of Africa in regard to the competing isms, pan-isms, pan-Ethiopianism and pan-Somalism, and to explain a little bit, the roots and the context, especially in the era of decolonization, to get to the concepts of Greater Ethiopia and Greater Somalia, and then, to discuss the root causes of the failure of the pan-isms, and then we can have a space for a debate, because we'll see if it's still relevant or not. I think it is. So, Pan-Ethiopianism and Pan-Somalism, what do I mean by that? I basically mean, Greater Ethiopia and Greater Somalia as two sort of expansionist concepts based on centralization as well as exclusion. I think these two keywords will keep coming back not only in this presentation, but also in other papers, I do believe, like by Balázs and Alemayo. Both actually these isms came as a result of complex set of root causes, which include historical, ethnic, social, or socio-political, as well as socio-economic, and of course international factors such as colonialism, decolonization, as well as later on the Cold War context. That's obvious. I mean, primarily their competition was had a lot to do with the Cold War context, obviously. And as I try to argue, both basically failed due to similar reasons. As I said, both were highly centralized, systems based on exclusion rather than inclusion, despite the fact that their constitutions were claiming something different. And both were very much top down, shared very much top-down approach, having very little to do with the reality on the ground, with the ethnic, in the case of Ethiopia, or a clan-based complexity in the case of Somalia. And so, as I argue, the competition of these two projects, let's put it this way, left the Horn of Africa in quite a volatile or fragile situation up to this day. And what we see today in particularly in Ethiopia, but also in Somalia, is kind of a continuation of what I am talking about. So I already mentioned decolonization, meaning the era of, let's say, roughly 1950s and 60s in Africa, characterized by the rise of Pan-Africanism and its competition with other pan-isms as pan-Islamism, pan-Arabism, etc. While pan-Ethiopianism, pan-Somalism, I see as kind of branches of pan-Africanism. But the era of decolonization, because I mean the issue of Eritrea and the incorporation of Eritrea into the first the federation and then the unitary state with Ethiopia, and the issue of fusion of Italian Somalia and British Somaliland and creation of the independent state of Somalia left definitely some traces and paved the way to a further development of both isms, as I call them. But what we can see still up to this day, kind of in many ways, kind of unresolved issues in the region, is particularly in the case of Ethiopia, the issue of land. very much centralized approach to the land, which remains one of the unresolved issues in Ethiopia, creating significant inequalities in the society, and subsequently paving way to the rise of ethno-nationalist or ethno-regional movements, etc., etc. The Somali-speaking population being divided into five different political entities. During the colonial period, Ethiopia, Kenya, French Somaliland, or what is now Djibouti, and British Somaliland and Italian Somalia, which at the end of the day in 1960 formed the independent state of Somalia. And last but not least, one aspect that led to further competition of both projects was the unresolved border issue between Ethiopia and Somalia, particularly between Ethiopia and what used to be Italian Somalia during the colonial period, which we know from the past, already in the 1920s and early 30s, played a role as kind of a pretext to the Italian invasion to Ethiopia. And of course, the complex set of unresolved problems that kept coming up in the decades after that was quite long. So what do I mean by Greater Ethiopia, or how we can characterize the so-called Greater Ethiopia? It was a highly centralized, and I would really, in the case of Ethiopia, put emphasis on the word centralized, because Ethiopia at the time was one of the most centralized states in Africa, with a very much top-down nation-building project centered around three key pillars that, if you read the constitutions of 1931 or later on the revised version of 1955, what you can see is that the Ethiopian, let's say, greatness is defined by three key pillars: the emperor, the Ethiopian Orthodox Church, and the Amharic language as the only official sort of allowed language to be spoken publicly. The high level of centralization played, of course, its role in the war for independence of Eritrea, because from the very beginning, with the centralized nature of the Ethiopian state, it was, sure that the federation was not predestined to live long, and so it was only a matter of time until it turned into a unitary state, which finally happened in 1962, and paved the way for a future or subsequent war for independence of the Eritreans, and later on accelerated the ethno-nationalist or ethno-regional movements in Ethiopia, with the creation of the so-called liberation fronts from roughly mid-70s onwards. So this inability of the government to see a complex set of issues, a combination of socioeconomic inequalities with the, let's say, influx of various international factors such as Marxism and socialism, combined with ethnic and religious, regional differences and inability to deal with the issue of accommodation of diversity, all these factors contributed to the fall of the regime, which was replaced by Marxist military junta de Derg that, on one hand, was supposed to reshape or rebuild the country, according to the official rhetoric of Mengistu Haile Mariam, but at the same time continued in a very much centralizing and top-down approach towards nation building based on those two keywords that I already mentioned, centralization and exclusion rather than inclusion. And in the general context of the Cold War, this led to a further growth of nationalist or ethno-nationalist movements that that basically overthrew the regime in 1991, of course, in a broader Cold War arena or context. While Greater Somalia, unlike Ethiopia, Somalia was rather a real victim, or Somali-speaking people, a victim of the colonial partition of Africa. while Ethiopia, in a certain sense, benefited from colonialism, at least in a sense of incorporating Eritrea into its territory and creating this, you know, greater entity, greater Ethiopia. But Somalia, despite the fact that it's a relatively homogeneous country, unlike the majority of other African countries, is a clan-based society. And despite the attempts to by various political actors to overcome clan differences already in the era of decolonization, the official rhetoric, particularly by Siad Barre after 1969, after the coup in 1969, did not correspond to reality, because actually the policy of Siad Barre's dictatorship, again, very much centralized, expansionist and exclusionist state, was based on actually clan favoritism, in which clans whose origin was in southern part of Somalia were privileged by, while more and more it became revealed, it was that the northern Somali clans were pretty much disadvantaged and sort of excluded from the nation building and decision making processes. And so only it was basically the invasion of the Somali forces to Ethiopia in 1977-78, which revealed these problems of the clan-based society and regional differences and kind of a hypocrisy of the regime, actually. And the Ogaden War and the failure or the defeat of the Somali forces only sort of paved the way towards further fragmentation of the Somali state into roughly, you know, the previous colonial borders of British Somaliland and Italian Somalia. So the fall of these pan-isms actually took place in 1991. When the regimes collapsed and were replaced by new sort of reality on the ground, by the independence of Eritrea, by the unilaterally proclaimed independence of the Republic of Somaliland, which according to many scholars can be seen as a people's project instead of and a project of an elite of previous regimes in both countries, and the new federal setup of Ethiopia, which I'm not going to talk about deeper because we don't have time for that, and there are other speakers who will touch this issue for sure. But the federal setup again existed, in my opinion, rather on paper rather than in reality. I don't see any real federation of, let's say, Swiss or American type being implemented in Ethiopia, because again, what followed after 1991 was a very much top-down, centralized approach towards nation building and state building. And so here we get to the point, if, you know, those issues from the past, from, let's say, the Cold War era are still relevant, or if we can see some traces here and there. And I think that it is, that we should learn a bit from the past, because these highly centralizing tendencies in both countries led to, or helped to spark, ethno-regional, in the case of Ethiopia, and clan-based, in the case of Somalia, movements. And we can see that military responses of both regimes towards the, let's say, regional claims or demands only deepened grievances and minimized the chances for peaceful reconciliation. So, as I said, centralization and exclusion combined with visible internal divisions, hypocrisy of ruling elites and the top-down imposed nationalist project mixed with high level of militarization led to basically a failure of these projects, which, as I say, we can take as an inspiration for the debates of what is going on in Ethiopia these days. So I hope I made it in 15 minutes. Thank you very much for your attention. Pity I cannot be in touch, and I'm here for your questions. Thank you. Kesenam Sepen.
Thank you very much. And applause to you, actually. Yes, so thank you very much, Jan. Actually, perfect timing. Even you saved 2 minutes, so thank you for that. We are right away going to continue with Balázs Szélinger, who is going to address the Ethiopia Utopia, a very interesting title, very much connected most probably to the historical context you were talking about, which then will be followed with two more presentations connected with the region, connected with Ethiopia, especially, after which, after the four presentations, we are going to have a discussion session. So.
Thank you very much. Thank you, first of all, inviting me to this conference. And I would like to say some introductory words, a little bit about myself, not to promote myself, but to make you understand why I'm here. Actually, I'm a researcher of Ethiopian history, contemporary history, for almost 30 years now. Also, I've been living in Ethiopia for a considerable time. First time having been there 23 years ago. Lately, my latest position in Ethiopia was as a diplomat based in Addis Ababa, which is just ended in June this year. And as a diplomat for the Embassy of Hungary in Addis Ababa, Ethiopia, I also followed very closely the policies of the European Union in Addis Ababa, which was already very interesting. And before that, which is maybe more relevant than my diplomatic position, I've been assistant professor at Makale University in Tigray, which is the core of the conflict zone at the moment in Ethiopia. Now, if you don't mind me, I would like to make a little bit interactive for a moment this presentation. And please, those raise your hands who are following the recent conflict in Ethiopia, which started in last November. Yes, I expected a very few. So therefore, if Mr. Organizer István don't mind me, I would like to use the two minutes Jan left to explain a little bit of this conflict. So as Jan already mentioned, the communist regime fell down in 1991 in Ethiopia. After a very, very long civil war, in which for regional, for political formation, what we call TPLF, the Tigray People's Liberation Front, basically entered Addis Ababa, and that was the main cause of the fall of the communist regime. Now, from 1991, this TPLF, Tigray People Liberation Front, formed a coalition of parties in which, of course, they played the main role, and they maintained their rule for 27 or 28 years, which other ethnic groups in Ethiopia perceived, especially the Amhara and the Oromo, perceived as the dictatorial regime of the Tigrayan people. Now, this regime of the Tigray People Liberation Front, the TPLF, came to an end in 2018, which means 3 years ago. And since then, we have seen an escalation of events, which concluded in a war early last November. And what we are doing here now in this panel, trying to explain what was the causes of this conflict, what are the consequences, and what is happening actually in these days, because the conflict, unfortunately, is very, very far from over, as we see now. So that's why it's so exciting for us participating in this panel, because we are talking about a recent ongoing war and political conflict between Addis Ababa and that is already a question, because I mentioned several times, for example, that it was the TPLF, the Tigray People's Liberation Front, which is in the focus of this conflict on one hand, but some people, when the war started last November, they already told that, oh, history repeats itself, because the Tigrayans are fighting against the center, Addis Ababa again. We have seen it before. It was when they were fighting against the Derg. But here we have one difference already, and in my presentation today, I would like to talk about those aspects of this conflict which are many times overlooked. We know a lot of very, very obvious and simple causes of this conflict, but there are small details which are often overlooked, and here we already have one. Because in these days, and since November, this is not the TPLF which is fighting against the Ethiopian National Defense Forces. And I will come to that point later on again, but officially, this is not the Tigray People's Liberation Front, because they formed a new military power called Tigray Defense Forces, the TDF. Obviously, why? Because they wanted to show to Ethiopia, to Addis Ababa, and the outside world, that this is not one political unit fighting against Addis Ababa, but the whole Tigrayan people. This is not the TPLF, this is the Tigray Defense Forces. We're gonna defend ourselves, they say. This is what their perception is. Now coming to my actual presentation, when I prepared this presentation, I was in a hurry to give the organizers the title and everything, and I just came later on to the conclusion that this Ethiopia Utopia is not the right title, so if I would have more time, I would call my presentation as a lesson in violence. So I just put this quotation on the title page, a quotation from my very favorite rock band called Exodus, because this is not a coincidence, because us who are following Ethiopian politics very closely for decades or many, many years, it was very obvious and clear that this conflict, this war is coming. There was no real surprise. What surprised me, actually, personally, was how my friends were reacting to this war. And I have friends from many, many different ethnic groups in Ethiopia. Most of them, obviously, are from the Amhara ethnic group, which is the historical ruling ethnic group in Ethiopia. All the emperors in the imperial times, except one, were Amhara emperors, and still they have a big economic and political and cultural power in Ethiopia. And of course, because I've been working for 4 years in the heart of Tigray, among Tigrayans, I also have many, many Tigrayan friends. And what was shocking for me, how my Amhara friends are reacting to this conflict. Because when it started, many people, including the European Union, which I followed because of my diplomatic post, were raising humanitarian crisis questions, that a lot of people are dying, women gonna be raped, there is starvation, millions of internationally displaced people, and so on. And we raised these questions. And shockingly, some of my friends, I don't say all, but some of my friends, educated people with university, high-level PhD educations, medical doctors, some of them, their reaction was, don't mind, they just get what they deserve. That was their reaction. So there is this very ethnic aspect of this conflict that behind the political lines, behind the military, there is something which I just can call pure revenge. For the past 28 years, what the TPLF, when the TPLF was in power. And really, they committed a lot of unlawful things in Ethiopia. So I don't say Tigrayans or TPLF are innocent angels, and I'm very, very far from that. But I just want to make you see that how both sides are sometimes, I'm sorry to say, but out of their mind. And this quotation from my one of my favorite brand is just fits to this presentation. And again, when you read different analyses about this conflict in very high level political journals and magazines and on the internet, they usually start the conflict with a military event. When the TPLF occupied the National Army's so-called northern base. But I already told you that some of us already seen this conflict and war coming. So we have to find the starting point for this conflict. And if I want to grab one, for me, this is the question of elections and the question of legitimacy. As I told you before, in 2018, the TPLF fell out of power. How? Because their coalition, in which they led the leading role, finally decided to have a prime minister who is not of Tigrayan origin, but of Oromo origin. And therefore, gradually from 2018, that means 3 years ago, the Tigrayans and the TPLF gradually fell out of power, gradually even retreating from Addis Ababa to their home base in Makale, where they had an elected leader of the TPLF and not soon later elected acting president of Tigray Regional State, and that is on the left side of this picture, Dr. Debretzion. That's his name. Meanwhile, for 3 years, a little bit more, we had a prime minister of Ethiopia who is on the right side, who acted in power without any elections, actually. And we had for 3 years this very interesting situation, and that's what I call the question of legitimacy, that we had in Tigray Regional State a president who was democratically elected, and we had a prime minister no one voted for. Yes? So this is a very delicate situation, and I think this was the root cause of the problem, because here we have a question of legitimacy. Now, in the previous, not previous, but the presentation of Dr. Mohamed Salim, we heard about a lot of questions of democracy and legitimacy. And in his conclusions, if you may remember, he touched this topic, which I would like to call a democracy from above. That means when the state is imposing or trying to impose democracy on the society. Meanwhile, we have, in fact, a grassroots democracy many times on ground, and that's the case in Tigray, Ethiopia, where TPLF is a very, very highly democratic party, I would like to say, based on centuries or probably 1,000 years old local democratic institution called the Baito system, which is basically a local, I would say a pastoral or village democracy, when every small village community deciding every single question democratically under the big tree where all the men gather. The women are around, and you know, from our Western point of view, we used to say, okay, only the men are involved and the women are excluded. No, the women are there and they are surrounding the tree and they are listening, and all those men have to go home in the evening, so the woman really has something. Coming to the TPLF, based on this ancient Baito system, all leaders are elected, including women, and that's what makes a huge difference, because TPLF, from the start of this political party, which is 1974, women played a role, a very high role, in the Tigray People Liberation Front. What is important here, that Tigray, they needed an election organized in 2020. I'm talking about Ethiopia now, according to the constitution, which was supposed to be in 2020, August, I guess. But then the pandemic came, and the prime minister started to postpone these elections more and more. Meanwhile, Debretzion, the president of Tigray state, told, I'm very sorry, I'll be a little bit, 1 minute more maybe, told that, no, we're going to go on with the elections in Tigray. And this caused a very high level conflict, but I would skip this part because we don't have time. For this, we should examine a little bit the Ethiopian constitution, because both parties started to point out to each other that you are illegal, no, you are illegal. But what the constitution says, to spare time, I will not read this different point of the constitution, because we don't have time for that. I just summarize what I want to say about that. The constitution is very badly phrased, because it just simply doesn't say anything about constitutions in case of state of emergency. So basically, both sides could pick up one paragraph of the constitution to support their own ideas. Now, what is important, a point which is many times overlooked about the TPLF, the Tigray People Liberation Front. This is not an ordinary party. We used to be familiar with parties which are political parties. They have a main branch in Addis Ababa and maybe a few branches here and there in major cities. This is not the case. This is a political party organized from below. First of all, TPLF really have a branch in every single Tigrayan village. This is really a people-based party. And this is a mistake which political decision makers in Ethiopia made, I believe, is that they didn't count with that, that they cannot differentiate between the TPLF and the Tigrayan people. This is a party which won the elections, as you have seen in the last slide, in August 2020, won an election over 90%. And this was a fair and democratic elections, even according to the opinion of Tigrayan opposition parties, because there are opposition parties in Tigray, which is very surprising, but there are. And even I know some of them personally, and they said, no, these elections were fair and democratic and transparent. That means over 90% of the Tigrayan population voted for this party. This is true. No cheating. About Mesai Kebede, who you may not know, I like him. In my opinion, he's one of the best contemporary philosophers of Ethiopia, formerly teaching at Addis Ababa University, then chased away from Ethiopia by the TPLF. So now, for more than two decades, he's residing in the United States. It's easy to be a philosopher in the United States. But a couple of weeks ago or months ago, he posted it in a Yahoo discussion channel. When he says, I might confess about my most spectacular failure in my understanding of Ethiopian politics. Together with many Ethiopian political analysts, I thought that, with the exception of elites, the Tigrayan people will rise up against the TPLF at the slightest sign of weakness. Really? after an election, which they won over 90%, you really believe that? So what I thought about that, because I like Mesekebed as a philosopher. So after Karl Marx, we have to learn again that an excellent philosopher is not necessarily a good political scientist, right? Yes. Now, something about, probably a little bit about the future. 1 minute only, sorry for that. How the Tigrayans are perceiving the conflict. Two opinions of young Tigrayans. The first one, before the war, but after the elections in Tigray, saying that, for me, Tigray is the cornerstone of Ethiopian nationalism. With all the history and religion there is, I don't think there is anyone more Ethiopian than us. And then the war started. Then thousands of Tigrayans died. Thousands of Tigrayan women were raped, looted. Churches, monasteries, mosques looted and ruined to the ground. And here we are now, then most of the Tigrayans at the moment, I would like to emphasize it, don't want to be Ethiopians anymore. And meanwhile, the TPLF wants to be in Ethiopia. There is a lot of misinformation and fake news about it. Oh, TPLF is fighting against Ethiopians because they want to make a separate state. Look at their official statements until today. They want to stay in Ethiopia. And they are fighting, theoretically, against their own population who doesn't want to be Ethiopian anymore. TPLF wants to stay in Ethiopia, but they want to, reform it. Yes, I don't want to stretch the time much more. So thank you for your attention. I hope at least I raised some questions. Thank you.
Yes, yes, thank you very much. You certainly have raised further important questions, also adding to those your personal, stories, which I think are truly important for our understanding. Let's continue with yet another approach, overview of the root causes, because you also talked about the root causes of contemporary conflicts in the region. So please welcome Dr. Kumsa, who has two affiliations in the Czech Republic. One is with Škoda Auto University, and the other one is Charles University in Prague. And he will be looking at the root causes of the contemporary regional war in the Horn of Africa region.
Thank you very much for organizing this excellent conference. The title of my paper is The Root Causes of the Contemporary Regional War in the Horn of Africa. Subtitles are Historical Background of the Conflict, The Ideological Difference as the Cause of the Contemporary War, finally, we will see the Statue of the International Criminal Court. Finally, I will present four scenarios. Which group will win the contemporary war in Ethiopia? So I prepared reading my paper to save my time. Ethiopia is one of the cruelest wars of this century, starting from 4th of November 2020 until today. This war was declared by the Colonel Abiy Ahmed Ali, the Prime Minister of Federal Democratic Republic of Ethiopia, or FDRE, on the state of Tigray, one of the member states of this federation. He claimed that the reason why they declared war against the member state of FDRE, or the federation, is the TPLF attempted, this is his word, attempted to rob military weapon, and he declared, I quote, in the early morning of November 4, 2020, the Tigray People's Liberation Front, TPLF, attacked the Ethiopian National Defense Force based located in Tigray region, attempted to rob the Northern Command of artillery and military equipment, unquote. And he gave order to wage war against the Tigray nation. He stated that the Ethiopian National Defense Force, under the direction of a command post, have been ordered to carry out their mission to save the country and the region from the spiraling into instability, unquote. According to the Prime Minister, TPLF attempted to rob the Northern Command military equipment. If what is telling to the world is an attempt of military robbery by a group of TPLF, when he organized the foreign forces, namely huge Eritrean Defense Force, Somali soldiers, and a drone from United Arab Emirates, he declared of war on the state of Tigray on the same day, on the 4th of November. The same day of ordering the war, on official website of his office. His reasoning to go to war against one of the founding member states of the Federation is not convincing. It is better to search for the development of this conflict, which brought brutal war to Tigray state. Historical background of the conflict in Ethiopia, not only this contemporary war. The real understanding of the root of the contemporary violent conflict in Ethiopia was originated in the foundation of Imperial Ethiopia by Abyssinian King Menelik II, participating in the scramble for Africa, colonizing neighboring independent nations. During the conquest, the occupation of three nations from 1876 to the beginning of 20th century, compared with all colonizers, Leopold II of Belgium, Imperial Germany, France, Britain, Italy, Portugal, and Spain, Abyssinia was the worst in number of people killed in the war of conquest, slavery, and the brutal rule after conquest. According to published books at the end of 19th century, in the beginning to 20th century, the atrocity done against the conquered people has follows. The Oromo population reduced from 10 million to 5 million, or half of the population. The Kaficho, Kafa, coffee is coming from that region. Kaficho reduced to the third of its population, to be specific, 67% of the people were perished. The Gimera people from 100,000 to about 20,000, which means 80% of the population consumed by the colonial war, slavery in the Maji people from 45,000 to 3,000 people, which means 94% people were perished by Abyssinian war of occupation and the slavery. For example, now Gimera is called Shawa Gimera, because they moved Amhara people from Shawa and they settled there, and the name of the region was changed to Shawagamira, like York in Great Britain. In America, it is New York, because the settlers named the new area by their origin. The military culture of Ethiopian army also rooted in the history of brutality during conquest and the occupation of free people. To illustrate only by one example, Marshal de Salvaic, in French clergyman and anthropologist who lived during that war in Ethiopia, stated in his book, I quote, "The conduct of Abyssinian armies invading a land is simply barbaric. They contravened sudden eruption more often at night. At daybreak, the fire begins, surprised men in the huts or in the field are three-quarter massacred and horribly mutilated. The women and the children and the many men are reduced to captivity. The soldiers lead the frightened herds toward the camp, take away the grain and the flour which they load on the shoulders of their prisoners, spurred on by blow of whip, destroy the harvest, then glutted with booties and intoxicated with blood, go to walk a bit farther from the devastation. That is what they call civilizing the land," unquote. One of the aim of Menelik II was to depopulate the area and the remaining people to put in objective poverty. As Salviak writes, at the beginning of his exploit, Menelik II brought only one day, brought back from Oromia region to Abyssinia 10,000 oxen and several thousand of slaves from one campaign, not include booty of the subordinate officers, unquote. It is very important to remind that oxen are very important domestic animal in that part of the world because they used for plowing the land. Without oxen, the peasant will exposed to famine, such as the worst one from 1888 to 1892, which, according to some estimate, one-third of the population of Ethiopia perished by the consequence of this man-made calamity. During the conquest war, so many people were killed, and others captured and became slaves, and Menelik II and his wife became the largest slave owners, having at one time 70,000 slaves. The Tigray nation is also became the victim of Italian Abyssinian agreement of October 1896, which is known as Addis Ababa Treaty, which includes Ethiopia's recognition of Italian claim over the majority of the major part of Tigray land, particularly southern part of Eritrea, known as Hamasen. The war between Italy and Abyssinia took place in 1895-96, which concluded on 1st of March 1896 by crushing defeat of Italian army. If Menelik II considered the Tigrayan people as Abyssinians, why he did not expel the Italians from old Tigray land? Why he able to sign agreement with the foreign state to divide his imperial territory? The cause of Ethiopian-Eritrean war from 1961 to 1991, according to Eritrean argument, is that if we are Abyssinians, how Abyssinian emperor, after crushing defeat of Italian army at Adua city, recognized part of his imperial territory has a colony of foreign power. This treaty divided the territory of Tigray people into territory. Now if we see national groups in Eritrea, Tigrayans are 55%. Tigray, northern part of Tigray. There are three problematic names: Tigray in Tigray, Tigrinya in Eritrea, Tigray in the northern Eritrea. Originally, three of them are the same people. Because of this Tigray, now they changed to Tigray, Tigrinya, and Tigray. the majority of the people in Eritrea now are Tigrayans. Others are minority groups, to save my time. The devastating Ethio-Eritrean War of 1998-2000 was legally unforgettable mistake of TPLF-led government of Ethiopia in 1993. Ethiopia is the first state to recognize Eritrea as independent state. The mistake was that to recognize one state, one of the fundamental criteria is to have demarcated boundary. Eritrea was one of the 14, I will jump this. Okay, ideological difference of contemporary conflict. The Tigrayans and the other Oromo, Somali, Sidama, and others, 9 states from 10 states of Ethiopian Federation, they support this contemporary constitution which recognize their identity in their territory and to speak and to teach their children by their mother tongue. But Prosperity Party, which now be created with Amara extremist group, they wanted to destroy this constitution and go back to pre-1974 system of governance in which one language, Amharic language, one religion, Ethiopian Orthodox Church, and they wanted to return back and to give land to the Malkanyas or occupier soldiers of Minilik. So this is not acceptable for the all nations in Ethiopia except the Amhara ruling class. Now the Tigrayan people became like colonial people with others. Why? Because if you see this map, the southern part and the western part, the Amhara state government said it belongs to them, and now they occupy this territory. The northern part, the Eritrean army are occupying that area. They are now try to crush Tigrayans from the north and from the south. So three groups have common interest. That is Prosperity Party, which is led by Abiy. Why? He wanted to rule Ethiopia under one control. Amharans, they wanted the territory of Tigray, and that Eritrea also, they wanted the part of Tigrayan territory. Okay, if we went through the International Criminal Court law, what is happening in Tigray is shocking. Raping of women will happen in the war, but in group, raping women and the putting a stone in their organ, it is unbelievable to see on CNN what is happening in Tigray. Second, 69 bodies, corpses, were found in the river in Sudan, which the fishers saw suddenly what is going on. Killing people and throwing it to the river, like in what happened in Rwanda 1994, blocking all highways to Tigray, blocking them, not to get food. Famine has a weapon of war. You cannot count what is happening now in Tigray. And other assassinations, generals, political leaders, artists were assassinated during this person leadership, who get Nobel Prize for peace. You cannot imagine how he changed completely. Okay, finally, we can raise in discussion four scenarios. What will going to happen? We don't know exactly what will happen, but one can be happen. One, coalition of Ethiopian National Defense Force, Amara Special Force, Amara Fano Militia, and the Eritrean National Defense Force can win the war and can change the constitution to a unitary state under the hegemony of Amara political elite. The second, Tigray Defense Force coalition with other national defense forces like Oromo Liberation Front, Sidama National Defense Force, Gambella, and others can win the war to save the existing constitution. The third, Tigray will win and declare its independence from Ethiopia. The fourth, no group will win. The war will continue for a long time, stalemate. Last week, Antonio Guterres, Secretary General of United Nations, gave interview on BBC. He said, Tigray People's Liberation Front is deeply integrated in the Tigray society. Consequently, it is not possible to defeat it. Second, TPLF cannot defeat its opponents in the again to rule Ethiopia. The solution for this brutal conflict is to stop the war and come to a round table, negotiate for peaceful solution. I share his scenario. Galatoma, thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Dr. Kumsa. We are coming to our final contribution this morning, and that will be basically a co-authored paper by a PhD candidate and a professor. His professor, Ahmed Abdulatif Abdulkader, will be giving the presentation on behalf of Professor Nesmi as well. And again, the ongoing war will be looked at from other dimensions. Yes, 15 minutes max, so that we can have at least a couple of questions and then the lunch. Go ahead. Thank you.
Chairman, distinguished professors and participants, my name is Györ Nesmélyi, professor of Budapest Business School, University of Applied Sciences. And as a former diplomat, I also served at various African countries at the Hungarian embassies. But from the point of our topic, it's not me who is the bigger attraction. I would like to introduce my co-author, Ahmed Abdulkader Abdullatif, who is my PhD student at the Hungarian University of Agriculture and Life Sciences. And why our presentation might be interesting beyond the academic value, because Ahmed just recently returned to Hungary. He was at home for primary research, finalizing his dissertation. And as his family, a part of his family is living in Tigray, he's from Afar region, the neighboring state in Ethiopia. He, who is the most peaceful person I ever seen in my life, got personally involved and influenced for a long time because he was stuck in the front line. We didn't know about his life for several weeks, and finally he had such an adventure that he could return finally home in healthy condition, but walked around 200 kilometers. So I give the floor to Ahmed, and besides the academic contribution, he is ready to tell you his personal first-hand experiences. Thank you very much. Ahmed, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. I think it is very tough to present after an extraordinary person's presentation because they are outsmart, but I will try as quick as possible and to be as smart as possible. The topic are very much related to the three presentations that has passed, especially Dr. The previous diplomat in Ethiopia, Hungary, in Hungarian embassy, has explained a lot about what is going on in Ethiopia. I will jump just this, and these three arrows are the areas where the war is circulating. The neighboring region in Amhara and Afar, where I am from, both actually. In the southern part of Tigray, where I am specifically living, where my families are as well, a place called Alamata, the one warada of the south, the Tigray part, which was previously in the Derg regime, it was in Amhara. Actually, there was no Amhara, there was Wollo. So it was part of it, and the Amhara regional state is claiming it as well. They are claiming both at the south of Tigray and south of, northeast of Tigray. These are the areas for now. Just about the governance in the past Ethiopian history, they have explained a lot, the monarchical communism and the current ethnic federalism. So I'm not going to discuss about it. Now, as earlier presenter mentioned about overlooked tiny details of reasons of the war. The one is the vacuum that is created post the days of Prime Minister Meles Zenawi, who ruled Ethiopia for like 21 years. And I think he was the dominant one in the party, and there the others were not that much involved in every activity. That's why when he died, things were very tough for Ethiopians. When the Hailemariam Desalegn, his predecessor, were not actually good at handling it. So there were imprisonment of several political prisoners. There were several protests in the country after his death. Such situations created a very, very huge political movement in the country. Those abroad were using social medias to mobilize the community, as well as funds to support the protesters within the country. In the aim, just to see the root causes, and the methodologies are, I was there in Ethiopia for like 13 months, especially when the war started, I was there in Alamata where the war started. And in the meantime, when the government took over the Tigray region in 3 weeks of time, again, I was in Mekelle that day. So the personal observation, the informal chat with both forces, the Tigrayan forces as well as the national Ethiopian armies, as well as I have contacted like more than 105 people who are affected by the war across the region. In result, the main causes among the overlooked details, there are several things, but capturing the metal works engineering corporation of Ethiopia, the Major General Kemfe, and just showing him on TV, makes the Ethiopian people to perceive they are being attacked by the federal government because they are singling out. They talk as a singling out a Tigrayan person who is in power and corrupted. That is one thing. The perception they took, one. The second one is an assassination attempt which was happened in Addis Ababa on the Prime Minister, the Abiy Ahmed. And following that assassination attempt, he gave a speech. And he mentioned hyena in the day. Like hyena is active at night, but he called hyena who eats the people on the day. And the Tigrayan people attach such terminology to themselves. And the same, the other Ethiopian people also attach it to Tigrayans. So things went wrong on the internalization and defining such bad words which come out from the leaders. And political ideological change. The Prosperity Party came in between the 5-year term of EPRDF, one, and the new premier came up with a liberal democratic system, while the Tigrayan party, the TPLF, preferred to continue with the developmental democracy. That is a big difference. And when they want to create the coalition of all parties that are available in the country, because former there were a front of four big regions party, that's the Oromia, Tigray, Southern Nations, and Amhara. These were the four parties that were leading the country. The other, the Afar, the Somali, the Benshangul, and the other six regions were excluded from the central government. So the new premier started to just bring all and make a unitary party at center and cancel the front that were four. So they didn't like, the TPLF didn't like such procedure. And the procedure to do it was to either to decide from the center and go down to the every region's assembly, or coming from bottom to up. The Tigrayan force wanted to go from bottom to up, and the premier wanted from top to down. So there were a big difference in that one, and they call it Medemer addition, this coalition. Again, as I mentioned earlier, postponing the election was one of the reasons for the war. And the issue of legitimacy. The TPLF said after September 30, they said the legitimacy of the federal government and any authority at the country is rejected. These were the main ones. At the end, and the most critical part, they attacked the military force based on the Tigray nation. So these were the main parties. Following that, what happened? Following the war, the declaration of the war, the National Army, in line with the Eritrean as well as the Amhara forces, took over Tigray in general in 3 weeks' time and captured the main one of the senior members of TPLF and killed some of the senior members in the meantime. And the search continued. The search continued for the senior members again and the leaders of Tigray. In the meantime, the government established an interim government with those parties which are opposing the Tigray Liberation Front, and the TPLF started guerrilla war when the federal government established interim. Then instability continued in the region. After 10 years approximately, the national government or the federal government decided to move out of Tigray for the sake of the Tigray farmers to plow and farm their lands and to be peaceful. Was that the reason? That is another issue. We believe there are some detailed things out there. But what happened in these 10 years or 11 years or 11 months of war? One, in Tigray, there were blackouts. No electricity at all in most of the Tigray parts. If there is no electricity, if there is no internet access, no banking service at all. If there is no banking access, even if you have money, you can't access it. If you don't access it, you can't feed yourself and your family. And while some of the historical places, especially the Aksum, which is well known, the airport is damaged. Who damaged it doesn't matter. It is already damaged. So no flight to take her to Aksum, where several tourists has been visiting. Again, the masjid, the Najashi, the mosque, which is well known in and well visited, one of the UNESCO registered heritages of Ethiopia, were again damaged by the war. Bridges were broken, no transportation access. Medical facilities, health centers, the medication, especially those diabetes and HIV patients were out of medicines. No school. I can say my sister was grade 8 when the COVID came. Now a few days back, she went out from there and I asked her, how are you and how is schooling? She said, I am third year eighth, grade 8 student. She is on her third year grade 8, including due to the COVID situations. So no education at all. The Amhara came, they gave them grade 8 examination, regional examination. They pass and they start to learn to start the high school grade 9 class. Again, the Tigray came, they canceled that examination. So the people are suffering at all. These are resources of maybe billions of dollars. These are a few of just the photos that I took and I got from some of the internet. And when I go to Tigray, when I was there, I have seen a lot of tanks and military machines which was burned in a small area. If I go the whole region, you can't imagine. So billions of dollars of the country is burning. So economically, we are losing a lot. Socially, we are losing a lot. Psychologically, the people is suffering a lot. Nowadays, the war continued to neighboring regions, to Afar and Amhara, and people have been displaced. And there's no way to aid corridors. Even the aid comes, it is impossible to distribute well. So people are dying, both in fighting as well as due to the war consequences. Challenging to humanitarian aids. You can see these are real pictures. There were massacres. The military, those, especially in Tigray part, those parts of those soldiers were very, very young, maybe 12, 13, 14 years old, I've seen. When you ask them why they are in, they said, my sister was raped, or my mother was killed, or my father was killed. So they saw that and they want to fight. When they came to power, Prime Minister Abiy Ahmed, he was accepted by most of the Tigrayan people, to be honest. And a lot of people say the same. Tigrayans agreed that they liked him when he came. They needed a change. Later, the effect of the war by the Eritrean forces especially were very alarming. So they decided to be part of their TPLF, side of their TPLF. So what should be done? And in conclusion, one, the way it was handled by the federal government, the things were, the way it was handled were poor, and the economy of the country is going very bad. I think you have heard Ethiopia has been developing, growing very fast in the early years, in the past 2-3 years, but now lack of social service are concerning issues for the community, and it has become a key to survival. The young boys who should be at school are fighting in the war, which will affect the future of Tigray and the Ethiopian people as well. So the only possible way is to sit and talk. There are no ways. Now it is between the federal government and the Tigray people. So it will take a long time, but no one will win unless they sit. And peace deal can be done before war, within war, and after war. So let us do it today, what will you say? What we would like to say is let's do it, say, sit And ceasefire doesn't need any preconditions. The Tigrayans were bringing several preconditions to ceasefire. And I don't think there should be a precondition to ceasefire. Peace should come first. So I would like to recommend that both sides should sit and start making ceasefire and come to solution. So peace for all of us. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ahmed and Jörg, for this very enlightening, shocking to some extent, paper. And I think we have had a very full-fledged session connected to one of the major conflict zones of the African continent, with its historical background, with its historical developmental phases, as well as the consequences of the ongoing war situations all around. We have a couple of questions now before lunch starts off. So those of you who have some questions or remarks, please come forward and be brief so that we can then have lunch. Any questions, any remarks? Via Zoom, if you have questions, just write in the chat. We can read that out for you. Yes, okay, first Balázs. There's another mic.
Okay, thank you very much. It is like a comment to Dr. Balázs. I think when you talk about election, you said premier is not legitimate in terms of coming to power without election. In the Ethiopian system, as far as I am concerned, the only election is for the party to rule, not the person who is going to rule. The person is elected within the party. Once the party is elected, whoever comes to power, he is the leader. He is elected. I think he's assumed to be a leader. So Abiy Ahmed came into power within the ruling party. So I believe he is legitimate until that September 30. After that, do we agree with the emergency, the COVID as an emergency call to extend the election or not? That is another question, because a lot of people, as you said, they took one line out of the constitution to support their argument. So I believe he is legitimate when he came to power. After that, we can argue on the legislative terminology. Thank you very much.
Dr. Seringer, please.
It's on? Yes, it's on. Yes, thank you for your comment. You are absolutely right. But I think I remember that I didn't say anything about the legitimacy myself. I said there were questions of legitimacy on both sides. And that sounds quite different, I think. Yes, and my comment is just only because I see a lot of students here, and just make it clear, in all presentations we were talking about war. In fact, in the official discourse of the Ethiopian government, it's not a war. Officially, they call it law enforcement operation, right? And this shows a lot what is behind. Thank you. And I believe the young lady wanted also to raise a question, so I give the microphone away, if you agree. Yes.
Help, yes.
Thank you. I just have a little comment about the whole discussion. So to me, it was interesting how different perspectives were like shown. But it was interesting the most your perspective. And it is interesting to me that you mentioned that it's interesting to see how economy and the military industry is involved in within the war. So do you think, it's a question for you, do you think that that's another reason for why this war is still continuing in Ethiopia? That's my question.
Mike is there.
Thank you.
Thank you for the question. Thank you.
Thank you. Actually, the reason, there are a lot of reasons for the war to continue. As I said earlier, the Tigrayan people were beside Abiy at the beginning, before the war started. Even when the war started, they were with the federal government. Later, there were atrocities by Eritrean forces in the country, in the region, I mean. So when people die, a lot of Tigrayans were died by and killed by the Eritrean forces, and when they were a lot of rapes, even group rapes, not only single ones, they start to hate and they start to accept the ideas that the TPLF were saying. The TPLF were saying this government, the federal government, the Abiy administration is coming to kill and to just avoid the Tigrayan people out of the nation. They were saying in their media, including the elite ones, were repeating it. So they became just used to the word, and when this happened, they start to accept and support the TPLF. Now, including the 11 years old child, he is in war. I hope it will continue as long as they don't sit for peace agreement. A lot of countries are putting sanctions, for example, the United States, and calling for ceasefires. No one is accepting. The federal government is simply giving press releases on matters of this deal by saying, I'm looking into it. And the Tigrayan forces are still continuing, and they are staying in Amhara. Even they have moved like more than 100 kilometers from their original border on the south side. So it will continue, I hope so. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Dr. Kumsa, there's first Dr. Kumsa, and then you second.
The problem with Dr. Abiy is starting from his coming to power. What now we cannot say something which is not on record because of thanks to the information technology. First, what he said, he is coming from Oromia state. First, what he said is to destroy Oromo National Movement. He officially in Kenya with Uhuru Kenyatta, in public speaking, he said, we have to destroy OLF and Al-Shabaab to have a peace in the region. But at that time, OLF was officially registered legal political organization in Ethiopia. Second, killing people at city squares. For example, in Dembidolo, they captured one young boy saying that he is an OLF member, calling the city people by force in the square. The police, the military gunned him down, and they forbidden his family to have his body to bury officially. Third, they killed a person, a young boy, and forced his mother to sit on the corpse. This all recorded in Beni Shangul state. The fanatic Amara group killed the individual on the market, cutting his hand and put on the spear, and they danced it. In Wallo, they brought four people from ambulance. They killed them on the square. Nobody takes action. We don't know the secret of killing of the general Sarai, the chief of staff, and his comrade at his home by his bodyguard and Amara state president. So what is happening in Ethiopia? We passed through our history in conflict, but this time is special. So the problem, what is going on in Ethiopia, is special case now.
Thank you. And the last question or comment, please.
Thank you. I have a question for you, Ahmed. I'm really curious about the interviews that you made. You mentioned that you have made more than 100 interviews. Could you tell us some personal experiences or point of view that were, for example, shocking for you or just very exciting?
I'm sorry, I didn't mention this earlier to save the time, but I didn't have the opportunity to meet my supervisor when I was there because of the lockdown of the internet. I flew from Addis Ababa because we in the eve of election, last election, you know, we have had a bad experience of elections. Post-election, there were always a conflict in the capital. So we were afraid, with my wife, were afraid to stay in Addis, and we flew to Mekelle so that we can travel to our family, which were Alamat southern part of Tigray. When we get in Mekelle, everything was closed and no medium of transportation at all. So we waited at hotel for like 12 or 13 days. The banks were closed. We finished our pocket money. To mention, I had $50 in my pocket that I planned to use for the transit that when I come back. So I searched for a black market, which I'm sorry to say, to use a black market. I used a black market. I searched in Mekelle and I got and exchanged it with a black market so that I can use it for my travel. Again, when we in searching, I couldn't find any medium of transportation. So I have to walk from Mekelle to Alamata. It is 108 something kilometer, but sometimes you have to move out of the main road and go inside. And it took us like 10 or 11 days of walking with my wife. It was very tough, to be honest. And in the meantime, they took my laptop as well. The Tigray militia took my laptop and they said they are going to examine it, what is inside. Okay, I told them, check it, and they gave me back. They said they don't have any clue about computer, so they said, we will check it somewhere. So where are you going? We have to go walk for 2 hours. So I told them I will come back one day. I left my laptop where my whole document of PhD was there. So I went to Alamata and stayed as long as until the transportation started. When it started again, I went there by medium of transportation, then walked for 2.5 hours to ask for my computer. It was not there. Again, they sent me somewhere. I went there. They said again, I have to go back to where I went. Then I have traveled 3-4 times here and there. Finally, I got it, of course. Yeah, but it was very difficult. Again, to come here, as I said, without internet, someone was managing my internet access and communicating with my supervisor on related to the dissertation. To come here again at the last, every corridor was closed. The Tigray forces were in Amhara as well as in Afar, so I don't know how to go. I used to use illegal way of transportation, including food, sometimes on a cart, so that I can get access to the northern part of Afar Ab'ala. I'm lucky to speak different languages. I speak Tigrinya, I speak Afaraf, because I am from both sides. I was lucky to have such languages to escape the days. Otherwise, it could have been very bad. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Probably when looking into, you know, conflict situations of this volume and multiplicity of problems, we might be shocked by, you know, hearing such stories, but this is part of the everyday realities once again. And I was really happy to have all of you, and all would share this, I'm sure, in the first panel to talk over many of the dimensions that are so much interconnected, revealing a number of aspects of this particular conflict region. We are going to continue, but after the lunch break. So thank you so much for the panelists, for the great papers, for your attention, and please come and join us outside for a nice buffet lunch, after which we are going to continue at 2 o'clock here. And there will be a panel focusing on other conflicts, but their management as well, from different other corners of the African continent. Thank you very much.